Good afternoon, everyone. In yesterday's class, we are discussing about the similarities and difference between the microcontroller, the microprocessor, and then the embedded system. What we have discussed is the similarities are what all the things which are required, like CPU, RAM, ROM, and then the serial interface, input devices, output devices, timers. All these things are required in both microprocessor as well as in microcontroller. The only difference is, as you can see in the block diagram, in case of microprocessor, all these devices, all these are connected outside the CPU, which is not there on chip. Whereas in case of microcontroller, all these timers, output, serial interface, RAM, ROM will be there on chip. So this is the difference between microprocessor and then the microcontroller. This we have discussed in the yesterday's class. As you can go through briefly, in case of general purpose microprocessor, the disadvantage is the system is bulkier and it is more expensive. Whereas the general purpose microprocessor have got the advantage of what? Versatility. That means the amount of RAM, ROM, IO ports required is in our hand. Whereas in case of microcontroller, the advantage is what? The cost and then the space and then the amount of power consumed. So these are the advantages in case of microcontroller, but disadvantage is what? It can be used for a few applications. And then briefly we have discussed about the embedded systems. Embedded systems can be defined as what? The devices or the systems which will do only one task at all the time. This we have discussed briefly in the yesterday's class. Then we have discussed the many applications of the embedded systems. As you can see that the applications varies from home to office to automobile. So there are n number of applications of embedded systems. Then we have briefly discussed about the different types of microcontrollers, maybe 8-bit microcontroller, 16-bit microcontroller, 32-bit microcontroller, and there are many companies which basically manufacture these microcontrollers. But as we have discussed, Intel is the basic company which manufactured this, and then it allowed the others to manufacture it, but with code compatibility. We have discussed about different criteria for choosing the microcontroller. As you can see that there are many reasons or many entities by which we can select the microcontroller, ranging from speed to packaging to power consumptions, and then to amount of ROM, RAM, IO ports, cost. Along with these, there are some other criteria like availability of software development tools, and then these are all basically required for choosing the microcontroller. Then we have started our discussion with 8051 microcontroller. We have briefly discussed about the block diagram of 8051. As you can see that all these things, that is CPU, oscillator, bus, IO, serial port, timers, ROM, RAM, interrupts will be there on a single chip. And you can see the different buses which are used to interconnect the CPU with RAM, ROM, IO ports, bus. And then we have discussed the detailed architecture of 8051. This part is what? The 8051, we have a arithmetic and logical unit, then different registers are used, like register A, register B, then program status word. A, B program status words are all 8-bit, whereas program counter and data pointer are 16-bit registers. 8051 is an 8-bit microcontroller. Most of the registers are of 8-bit. There are few registers like program counter and DPTR which are 16-bit. And then we have discussed special function registers. And then there is a ROM, and then there are four ports, port 0 through port 3, which are basically connected using the different latches. This we have discussed in the yesterday's class. Then we have started our discussion on the registers. As we have discussed that registers are basically used for storing the information, temporary results, right? So the registers may have the byte of data, or maybe having the address. Both can be stored in the registers. The data, if it is data, then it can be used for processing, adding, subtracting, any operations can be done. Or if you want to retrieve the data, or if you want to store the data in the memory, then the corresponding address is stored in the registers. As we have discussed, majority of the registers which are there in microcontroller, 8051 microcontroller, are 8-bit registers. These bits are known as from D0 to D7. D0 is known as what least significant bit, whereas D7 is known as what most significant bit. Now you can look at the register, right? D0, D1, D2, D3, D4, D5, D6, D7, total 8 bits are there. D0 being LSB and D7 being MSB. The most widely used register in 8051 is accumulator. This register is used for almost all arithmetic and logical instructions. We'll discuss these things in detail in module 2. Along with register A, we have other registers also known as what register B, and then register 0, register 1 through register 7. Keep in mind that A and B, if you look at the architecture of 8051, A and B are very nearer to arithmetic and logical unit, whereas register R0 through R7 will be there in a register bank. Such four register banks are there in 8051, bank 0, bank 1, bank 2, bank 3. We will discuss this in detail in the subsequent slides. Then, as we have discussed, there are two registers which are of 16 bit, known as what DPTR, which basically stands for data pointer, and then a PC known as what program counter. Further, data pointer can be divided into two parts, known as what DPL and then DPH, lower 8 bits and then higher 8 bits. And then there is a specific function of program counter. We will discuss that in the subsequent slides. Basically, program counter points to the next instruction which is to be executed. Then briefly, we have discussed about this, that there is an instruction by name MOV destination comma source. Here MOV is known as what the operand. This is known as what operation. MOV is the basically operation. This tells the processor what to do. So you can see that this is copy source to destination. So once this instruction is executed, whatever we have in the source will be copied to the destination. So destination content will change, whereas source content will remain same. So different MOV instruction, which falls under data transfer instructions. Again, this will discuss in detail in module 2. So you can see that MOV A comma hash of 55. 55 here is in data, right? This hash indicates it is the immediate data, immediate addressing mode. So once this instruction is executed, 55 will be copied into A. And similarly, we have discussed the function of each instruction here. Now, further we'll discuss about the function of one more register known as what program counter. As briefly we have discussed, the basic objective of program counter is what you can see. It is used to hold, or it is used to point to the address of the next instruction which is to be executed. You can visualize that we have written a program, like 10 line program. Let us assume that microcontroller is executing first instruction. So while the ALU is executing the first instruction, this program counter will point to the second instruction which is to be executed next. Moment ALU finishes first instruction and it comes to execution of second instruction, this program counter will point to the third instruction and then so on. So as the CPU fetches the opcode, opcode basically stands for operation code, from the program ROM. So the all these instructions will be executed, will be stored in ROM. The program counter is increasing to point to the next instruction. So as we are discussing about the example of program wherein we have 10 instructions, all these 10 instructions will be there in ROM. So we'll be taking one instruction at each time. And if ALU is executing 8th instruction, the program counter will point to 9th instruction, and then so on. The program counter is 16 bit wide, as we have discussed. DPTR and program counter are 16 bit registers. So the program addresses will be from 000 to FFFF. So total 64 kilobytes of code memory is possible in case of 8051. Again, keep in mind that the amount of RAM and then the amount of ROM what we have in 8051 obviously will vary if we choose the another microcontroller. And another important thing we need to keep in mind that when microcontroller is powered up, the basic memory, right, the starting memory will be 0000. It starts with 0000. Let us assume that we are executing some program and the address is 00FF, and then we have turned off the microprocessor. And again, if you turned up, right, if it powered up, then the starting address will be always 0000. Then one more important register in 8051 is known as what, PSW, which stands for program status word. And this register again is of 8 bit, as we have discussed. So program status word is a register. It is also known as what, flag register. Is an 8 bit register. Out of these 8 bits, only 6 bits are used for different applications. Among these 6 bits, 4 bits are used for condition of flags, and 2 bits are used for selecting a bank, and 2 bits are not used. Now, as we have discussed in the previous slides, the 8051 microcontroller has got 4 register banks, bank 0, bank 1, bank 2, and then bank 3. Then question comes, how to choose these banks, right? Suppose I want to use bank 3, then how to choose it? Or someone else may be using bank 0, then how to choose those banks? So those four banks can be selected using the 2 bits in a program status word. We'll discuss that in detail in the subsequent slides. So as you can see that out of 8 bits which are available in a program status word, that is from D0 to D7, only 6 bits we are using. And in those 6 bits, the 4 bits, right, are used for carry flag, auxiliary carry flag, parity flag, and then the overflow flag. So depending on what operation we are doing in a microcontroller, whether we are doing arithmetic operations, logical operations, depending on that operation, these flags will be either set or reset. Set means 1, reset means 0. These 4 flags are known as what, conditional flags, as you can see, meaning that they indicate some conditions that will be resulted after some instructions are executing. Let us assume that we are adding 2 bits, add source, add destination comma source. Once that instruction is executed, some of the bits will be altered, maybe carry, maybe auxiliary carry, maybe parity or overflow, whereas the two bits, that is program status word bit 3 and program status word bit 4, are designed as RS0 and RS1. So these 2 bits are used to select a bank, either bank 0, bank 1, bank 2, or bank 3. And remaining 2 bits are user definable. As of now, these 2 bits are unused. Now, getting into the detail of the program status word, like, it looks like this. You can see that total there are 8 bits are there, D0 to D7, D0 being LSB, D7 being most significant bit. So you can see that the LSB has got a parity flag, D0, and then D1 is unused. Then we have a overflow flag. Then 2 bits, D3 and D4, known as RS1 and then RS0. These 2 bits are basically used for selecting a bank. And then we have a F0, again it is not used. Then D6 is auxiliary carry flag, and then D7 is carry flag. So we need to understand the positioning of all these flags so that we can determine the condition of those flags. until and unless we know the positioning of the flags. For example, carry flag is positioned at D7, right? So if you don't know where exactly carry or where exactly auxiliary carry flag is there, it becomes very difficult to find out the status of these flags, whether they are set or reset. So you can see that carry flag is there at program status word at 7. This is carry flag. So meaning is what? Meaning of carry flag is if a carry is generated from this 7th bit, then this flag will be set, or else it is reset. We are performing some operation, maybe arithmetic, maybe logical operations. After the operation of that particular bit, if a carry is generated from D7, then carry flag is set. We'll discuss this with an example in the subsequent flags. Then we have a auxiliary carry flag at 6th position. This flag will be set or reset depending on if a carry is generated from D3 to D4. Again, we'll discuss this with an example. If we are, let us assume that we are adding the two numbers, 8-bit numbers, and if a carry is generated from D3 bit, that means we have 1 and 1 at D3 position and we are adding it. So 1 plus 1, 0, and a carry is generated. So during that, auxiliary carry flag will be set. If no, then it is reset. And then F0, again it is there at 5th position. This is available for user for general purpose applications. And then RS1 and then RS0 at 4th and 3rd position in a register. So these two are used for selecting a bank, as we have briefly discussed, and further we'll discuss in detail. And then we have a overflow flag at position 2. As name indicates, if the result is more than 8 bit, then this flag will be set, or else it is a reset. And then position 1 is user definable bit. And then finally, there is a parity flag at LSB. So this flag will be either set or reset depending on whether we have a odd number of ones or even number of ones once that particular operation is being done. So if you have a even number of ones, then parity flag is set. If you have a even number of ones, then parity flag is reset. So you can see at the bottom of the slide, RS1 and then RS0. We have a two bits. Two bits means we have the four combinations, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, and then 1, 1. Depending on them, the particular bank will be set. If both these bits, that is RS1 and RS0 are 0, 0, then register bank 0 is selected. If it is 0, 1, then register bank 1 is selected. If it is 1, 0, then register bank 2 is selected. And then finally, if both the bits are 1, RS1 and RS0 is 1, 1, then register bank 3 is selected. And then also the address is also there, right? As we know that each register bank has got 8 registers, R0 to R7. So you can see the addresses of those registers from 00 to 07, total 8 registers. If you are selecting register bank 1 by choosing these bits to be 0 and 1, then address of the registers will be from 08 to 0F, again 8 addresses for storing 8 registers, R0 to R7. And then if we choose the bits as 1 and 0 for RS1 and RS0, then register bank 2 will be selected. The address of register bank 2 will be from 1010H to 17H, again 8 addresses. And then finally, for choosing register bank 3, we need to choose RS1 and RS0 to be 1 and 1, and then address will be from 18H to 1F. So all in all, the registers which are there in the register bank, the addresses will be from 00 to 1F. So total 32 registers are available in 8051 microcontroller, that is R0 to R7 in each bank, bank 0 through bank 3. So 8 into 4, total 32 registers are there. and the address will be from 00 to 1F. Now it is left to the user to select those particular banks, whether they need to use bank 0 or bank 1, bank 2 or bank 3. Depending on which bank they want to use, accordingly we need to choose the bits for RS1 and then RS0. Now coming to the conditional flags, as we discussed that there are four conditional flags are there: carry flag, auxiliary carry flag, then overflow flag, and then the parity flag. Right. There are few instructions which we are mentioned here. There are many more instructions. All those instructions we can classify into different types: data transfer, arithmetic, logical, branch instruction, and then so on. Few of instructions are mentioned here. And then what happens to these flags that is mentioned here? So we have mentioned carry flag, overflow flag, and then the auxiliary carry flag. You can see the instructions here. The first instruction is add instruction, which falls under arithmetic instructions. So basically this instruction will add the two data which are there in the registers. Again, we can choose any registers which we want. So once this instruction is executed, the carry flag, the overflow flag, and then the auxiliary carry flag may be 1 or may be 0. In digital electronics, this X means don't know, right? That means this value may be 1 or this value may be 0. Next instruction is what? ADC, that is, this is with add with carry. So this instruction basically will add the two registers, and then it will add also carry, right? If carry is 1, 1 will be added. If carry is 0, if no carry, then 0 will be added. Again, in this case also, these are the status of the flags. Then this is subtract with borrow. Again, the condition of the flags are don't know, but this may be 1 or this may be 0. And then if you are coming to mul instruction, this mul instruction will multiply the content of the two registers. In this case, carry flag will be always 0, overflow flag will be don't know. Similarly for division, you can see the similarity, right? For add and subtract, carry, overflow, and auxiliary carry are don't know, maybe 0 or 1. For multiplication and then the division instructions, carry flag will be always 0, and then overflow flag is maybe 1 or 0. And then we have a one more instruction known as what? DA instruction. This instruction is a decimal adjust after addition. Please keep in mind that we'll be discussing in detail about all these instructions in the module 2. Here we will be discussing these instructions with respect to the status of the flags. So decimal adjust after addition instruction is basically used for adjusting the result after adding. As we know that, for example, if you are adding 6 and 7, 6 plus 7 is 13. But in case of hexadecimal, it is not 13. So we need to adjust that to 13. So once you add, say, for example, 5 and 5, result is 10. But if you are looking for 10 in case of microprocessor or microcontroller, we will not get 10. We will get it as an A. Because if you remember, the hexadecimal numbers are from 0 through 9. And then we have A, B, C, D, E, F. So 10 in decimal is A in case of hexadecimal. So as computer doesn't understand decimal number systems, so if you are adding 5 and 5, the answer will be A. But if you don't know the concept of decimal and hexadecimal number, we will be looking for 10, but answer will get it as an A in case of microcontroller as well as in microprocessor. So there will be a confusion. But for the users, I should get 5 plus 5 is equal to 10. So this DA instruction is used for that conversion. Then we have the instructions, rotate instructions. So in rotate instructions, only carry flag is affected. You can see that from DA further, all these instructions, only carry flag is affected. So we'll discuss these instructions further in the module 2. This is set instructions, these clear carry instructions. This is complement instruction, this is add instructions, This is OR instructions, MOV instruction, and then this is branch instruction, compare, jump on, not equal. So basically what this function will do, it will compare the two contents and then it jumps if it is not equal, if it is not equal. So these are the conditions of the flags, of different flags for different instructions. Don't get confused with the functioning of these instructions, because we'll discuss these things in the module 2 as we have discussed. Now let us take an example and do the addition, and then we'll fill the what happens to the carry flag, what happens to the auxiliary carry flag, and what happens to the parity flag. Example is what? We need to show the status of carry flag, auxiliary carry flag, and then the parity flag once this instruction is being executed. So there are two instructions which are using here. One is move instruction, which falls under data transfer instruction, and the next instruction is what? Add instruction, which falls under arithmetic instructions. So first instruction is what? Move a comma hash of 38h. As this is a data transfer instruction, here 38 is the data. Again, this hash indicates immediate addressing mode. There are different addressing modes are there. Immediate addressing mode is what? The 38 will be transferred or will be moved or will be copied to register A. So before execution of this instruction, the content of A may be anything, but after execution of this instruction, A will be copied with 38. And then next instruction, next immediate instruction is what? Add A with hash of 2F. Now keep in mind that now A consists of 38. So this instruction will add 38 with 2F. So here the addition is shown. 38 in binary is 0011, 8 is 1000, and the binary equivalent of 2F is 2 is 0010, F is 1111. Now add it. This addition we have discussed in digital electronics as well as in basic electronics. So there are four rules of addition. 0 plus 0 is 0, 0 plus 1 is 1, 1 plus 0 is 1, and then 1 plus 1 is 0 with a carry. So using that rule we need to add here. So 0 plus 1 is 1, 0 plus 1 is 1, 0 plus 1 is 1. Now if you are looking at the fourth bit of both the numbers which are 1, 1 and 1, so 1 and 1 is 0 with a carry. So 1 plus 1 plus 0 is 0 with a carry. So 1 plus 1 is 1, 0 plus 1 is 1, 1. So 1 is written here and then carry goes here. So 1 plus 0 plus 0 is 1. 0 plus 0 is 0. So the equivalent of this is 67. So now we have got the four bits 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1. Now we need to look at the these 8 bits from the perspective of program status word. Program status word is 8 bit, D0 through D7, and we can have the positioning of these bits, right? So this least significant bit at this position, we get the information about parity flag. At second position, we get the information of overflow flag. Then at sixth position, we'll get the information about auxiliary carry flag. And at the seventh position, we'll get the information about carry flag. But for the auxiliary carry flag, it depends on what happens at D3, whether a carry is generated from D3 to D4. So we need to understand the positioning of these conditional flags, and by looking at those bits, we need to mention about what is happening to carry flag, whether it is set or reset, what is happening to carry flag, whether it is set or reset, and what is happening at the parity flag, whether it is set or reset. Now look at the MSB. If you are looking at the MSB, there is no carry being generated because we are adding 0 with 0 and we are getting 0. So there is no carry generated from this bit, D7 bit or the MSB. So carry is equal to 0. Reason what we are giving is, since there is no carry beyond the D7 bit. By chance, if we have a 1 and 1 here, then 1 plus 1 is 0 and then carry generates. In that case, this carry flag will become 1, it will set. Now coming to auxiliary carry flag, its positioning is at 6th bit, but operation wise it will be looking at the D3 bit. So this is what the D3 bit, where we have 1 and then the 1. So 1 plus 1 is 0 and a carry is generated, that is gone to D4, from D3 to D4. So in that case, auxiliary carry becomes 1. Because reason what we are giving is, there is a carry from D3 to D4, basically it should be bit. And then coming to the parity flag, which is there at the D0. Now count the number of ones which we have in the answer. So we can count it as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That means we have an odd number of ones. So if you have an odd number of ones, then parity flag will be set, it will become 1. If you have an even number of ones, then parity flag will equals to 0. So reason what we are giving is, since the accumulator has an odd number of ones, so parity flag is equal to 1. So what I can suggest is, you can take the many more examples and then add it, or you can use any other instructions, because we have not discussed the different instructions. So what I suggest is, you add it, use the add instructions, take two numbers, add them, and then try to find out the status of all these flags, carry flag, auxiliary carry flag, and then the parity flag. Let us look at one more example. Right, again here also we are looking for the condition of carry flag, auxiliary carry flag, and then the parity flag. Two numbers are given as 9CH and 64H. You can take any number. So again, we are using the instruction. First instruction is what, move a comma hash of 9CH. After execution of this instruction, the A becomes 9C, because this is data transfer instructions and we are using immediate addressing mode. So 9C is the data that will be copied into A. And then next instruction, we are using add a comma hash of 64H. As we know that A is now 9CH, and we need to add 9CH with 64H. So we are adding here 9C and 64, equivalent of 9 in binary is 1001 and C is 1100, and then 64 is 0110 is 6 and 4 is 0100. Again, using the addition rules, we need to add this. 0 plus 0 is 0, 0 plus 0 is 0, 1 plus 1 is 0 with a carry, 1 plus 1 is 0 with a carry, 1 plus 1 is 0 with a carry, again 1 plus 1 is 0 with a carry, 1 plus 1 is 0 with a carry, and then finally also we have a carrier, so 1 plus 1 is 0, and then there will be a carry generated. Now if you are looking at the result, this result here is 0, 0, 0, 0 is 0, then 0, 0, 0, 0 is 0, and then a carry is generated. So total answer is 1, 0, 0. Now look at the bits with respect to the positioning of carry flag, auxiliary carry flag, and then the parity flag in a program status part. Now a carry flag is 1 because there is a carry generated from the D7 bit, right? So we got a carry from this D6 bit, so 1 plus 1 is 0, and then a carry generated. So for that purpose, and now carry flag is equal to 1. Reason is, since there is a carry beyond the D7 bit, then there is a auxiliary carry. Again, it is set because from D3 there is a carry generated to D4, and then look at the number of ones. All bits are 0, so we have an even number of ones. So this parity flag is equal to 0. This will set only when we have a odd number of ones in the answer. So look at the answer, and then look at the positioning of the these conditional flags in a program status word, and then with that we need to determine whether carry flag is set or reset, auxiliary carry flag is set or reset, or parity flag is set or reset. We can look at one more example. Again, here also we are using the same instruction, but we are taking different numbers. Again, here also, in this case also, we need to look at the status of these three flags, carry, auxiliary carry, and parity flag. So move a comma hash of 88. Again, keep in mind that this is a data transfer instructions, and we are copying the immediate data, 88 into a. And then next instruction is add a comma hash of 93. So we are adding in this case 88 with 93. The binary equivalent of 88 is 1000 and then 1000. Equivalent of 93 is 1001, 3001. Again, using the addition rules, add these two datas. So 0 plus 1 is 1, 0 plus 1 is 1, 0 plus 0 is 0, 1 plus 0 is 1, 0 plus 1 is 1. 0 plus 0 is 0, 0 plus 0 is 0, and then 1 plus 1 is 0, and then a carry is generated. So 0, 0, 0, 1 is 1, and then 1, 0, 1, 1 is B. The hexadecimal equivalent of 1, 0, 1, 1 is B. In decimal, it is 11. So this answer is 1, B, and then a carry is generated from this. So 1 plus 1 is 0 with a carry. So total answer is 11B. Now look at these bits, compare with contents of program status word with respect to carry flag, auxiliary carry flag, and then the parity flag. So you can see that there is a carry generated from the MSB or D7 bit. 1 plus 1 is 0 and the carry. So carry flag is set. Now look at the D3 position. So what we are adding here is we are adding 1 and 0. So 1, so there is no carry generated from D3 to D4. So for that reason, auxiliary carry flag is equal to 0. And then look at the number of 1s in an answer, which are 1, 2, 3, and then 4. That means we have an even number of 1s. So parity flag is equal to 0. Even though we are adding two 8-bit numbers, the final answer we are getting is 9 bits. So total 8 bits and then a carry. So don't take that into consideration. So answer is 8-bit only. So we need to count number of 1s in an 8-bit. If you take carry into consideration, then it becomes 5 bits. Then mistakenly you can quote this parity flag is equal to 1. So don't do that. We need to count the number of 1s in an 8-bit only. Then coming to RAM memory, again go back to the architecture of 8051, wherein up to now we have discussed about register A, register B, and then program status word in detail. So if you are looking at the amount of memory what we have in RAM is, RAM memory in case of 8051 is 128 bytes. So we can have the address from 00 to 7FH. These 128 bytes of memory, RAM memory, is subsequently divided into three groups, right? The first group of 32 bytes from location 00 to 1F, and these are used for register banks and then the stacks. As we have discussed that there are four register banks, bank 0, bank 1, bank 2, and then bank 3. And each bank has got 8 registers, so 8 into 4 is 32. So basically, out of 128 bytes, we need 32 bytes for registers, 32 registers, which are categorized into four register banks. And then further, we need 16 bytes out of these 128 bytes of RAM for bit addressable read write memory. So the addresses of these 16 byte bit addressable read write memory will start from 20H to 2F, and then remaining 80 bytes. So you can add these 80 plus 16 plus 32, it comes to 128 bytes. So total 80 bytes starting from 30H to 7FH are used for read and write storage. This is also known as what, scratch pad. So we need to remember the address of total RAM memory. So total address starts from 00 and set 7FH. Further from 00 to 1F, this will be used for register banks, total 32. After 1F, we'll get 20H. From 20H to 2FH, 16 byte will be used for bit addressable. And remaining 80, that is from 30 to 7FH, will be used as a scratch pad. So the organization of this RAM memory, total 128, it is shown in a figure wise, right? So this is from 00 to 7F, the total 128 byte. This 128 byte we have divided into different way. So from 00 to 07, register bank 0. From 8 to 0F, register bank 1. Then from 10 to, that is 10 to 17, register bank 2. From 18 to 1F, register bank 3. So you can see that from 00 to 1F, total 32 bytes. And then from 20 to 2F will be used for bit addressable RAM. And then further remaining 80, that is from 30 to 7F, 80 bytes will be used as a scratch pad. So in this way, the available 128 byte of RAM memory in 8051 are divided into different groups. Now coming to register banks, in case of program status word, we have discussed that two bits, that is RS1 and RS0, we are using for selecting the four available banks, bank 0 through bank 3. So the 32 bytes of the RAM memory are divided into four banks, as we have discussed in the previous slide. And each bank will be having 8-bit registers, that is R0 to R7. So RAM location from 0 to 7 are set aside for bank 0, and then from 8 to F for bank 1, and then so on. Don't get confused with what you can see, the registers in each bank have got the same name, that is same nomenclature, R0 to R7. But which bank we are using, that we need to set using the program status word, that is RS1 and then RS0. The most important thing we need to keep in mind, what happens when a 8051 is powered up. So when a 8051 is powered up, the default register bank is 0. Let us assume that a programmer is selected a bank 3, right, by choosing RS1 and RS0 to be 1 and 1. Right, so if you choose 1 and 1, then we are talking about, or we are working with register bank 3. Or in some cases, a programmer may be using bank 2 by choosing RS1 and RS0 bit appropriately. But moment you turned off the microcontroller and then powered up, then default bank will be 00. So we should know this. So each bank is shown here, the addresses of the RAM address of each bank. So R0, R1, R2 through R7 of bank 0. So all these R0 to R7 are replicated in all the banks, whether it is bank 0 or bank 1 or bank 2 or bank 3. So names are same, R0 to R7, but addresses are different. These are the addresses. So the address here is bank 0 address is, for bank 0, R0 address is 0 and R7 address is 7. Moment you come to bank 1, the address will change. So you can see the address of R7 is 7 in bank 0, whereas address of R7 in bank 1 is F, or address of R7 in bank 3 is 1F. So we should know the address of the registers which are there in the banks. Right, so then question comes, this we have discussed briefly, how to select a bank. So RS1, that is program status word bit 4, and then RS0 program status word bit 3. So depending on what bits we have in fourth and the third location in a program status word, if it is 00, bank 0 will be selected. If it is 01, bank 1 will be selected. If it is 10, bank 2 will be selected. If it is 1 and 1, then bank 3 will be selected. So bits D4 and D3 of the program status word are basically used for selecting the desired register bank. Use bit addressable instructions, that is a set B and then the clear to access program status word 4 and then the 3, right? From the last 2-3 previous slides, we are discussing about selecting a bank, right? So selecting a bank basically depends on these bits. Then question comes, how to make those particular bits 1 or 0. So that can be done using the two instructions, set and then the clear. As name indicates, set means 1, clear means 0. So use these instructions to select a particular bank. Again, these instructions we'll be discussing in module 2 in detail. Now, stack pointer we'll be discussing in the next class. So to summarize what we have discussed in today's class, we have started our discussion with the registers which are available in a microcontroller. We have started our discussion with two registers, register A, which is known as what, accumulator, and then the register B. The difference between the accumulator, register A and B, what we have in microcontroller. In case of microprocessor, we have only one register, that is known as what, accumulator. The significance of accumulator is, in most of the cases, register A is most widely used, and in most of the instruction, the default register is accumulator. We'll feel the significance of this accumulator register as and when we discuss the instructions and as and when we try to write programs using the different instructions. So both register A and register B are of 8 bit. And then apart from these registers A and then register B, we have 8 registers, R0 to R7. So register A, register B, R0 through R7 are all of 8 bit registers. The important thing is what, the registers R0 through R7, we have such 4 register banks. And then we have discussed 2 16 bit registers, known as what, a DPTR, which stands for data pointer. Further, this data pointer registers can be divided into 2, DPH and then DPL, lower 8 bits and then the higher 8 bits. And then we have one 16 bit registers known as what, program counter. And then one more important register we have discussed is what, the program status word. Again, it is a 8 bit register. Out of these 8 bits of program status word, 2 bits are not used. 2 bits are used for selecting a bank, as you can see, this RS1 and then RS0. Program status word, fourth bit and then the third bit are basically used for selecting a bank. And then remaining 4 bits, that means out of 8 bits, 2 bits are not used, 2 bits are used for selecting the bank, and remaining 4 bits are known as what, to show the status of a flag. So total 4 flags we have: carry flag, auxiliary carry flag, parity flag, and then the overflow flag. We have discussed the significance of all these 4 bits with examples, and briefly we have discussed about the 128 bytes of RAM and how we have divided that 128 bytes into 3 groups, right? 32 bytes are used for register banks, 16 bytes are used for bit addressable, and remaining 80 bytes are used for scratch pad. So this we have discussed. In the next class, we'll be discussing about the stack pointer, the significance of stack pointer. You'll be discussing about the push and pop instructions which are related to stack. Then we'll be discussing about the pin diagram of 8051, and then how to interface external RAM and ROM to this. Thank you. Thank you, Ananda.